sister. I'm elated to have my sister Lauren here.
Amen.
And this is the only other person besides my baby sister that I have a lot of sisters, but I refer to her as my flesh and blood. And I'm glad to have her here with me. I gotta hurry up and preach. We on a road trip down towards Philadelphia after I finish show. I can't be here too long because she'll be rolling her eyes at me. please excuse me. I know that there's a theme, and if we're conscious of it, I'm getting ready to start preaching in just a minute. With all that goes on in social media, and especially with the access we have to watching clips and people going live, sometimes what will happen is we don't want people to be able to say, oh, I heard them preach that before. And I was deliberately trying to read in the book of Judges, and I was reading about Samson, and I wanted to talk about playing with purpose. But God keeps bringing me back to this. And he told me, and my brother knows, and I'm comfortable with saying this too, to give a word to the house. So I just want to read one scripture, and I'll back up. But I'm going to kind of read the conclusion and then we'll go back. Is that all right?
All right.
1 Kings 18:41. We all know this verse. Elijah said unto Ahab, get thee up, eat, drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain. And Elijah said unto Ahab, get thee up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain. Just look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, the rain is coming.
Yes,
I wish somebody would receive that prophetically. Just look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, I know you've been in a famine, but tell them the rain is coming. If you believe it, come on, put your hands together. And y'all can clap your hands and give God a praise. Somebody shout, the rain is coming.
The rain is coming.
We are in a most troubling time in this world, and particularly in our country. We have, most of us did not live in the time of slavery. None of us lived in the time of slavery. And most of us missed the time of Jim Crow and segregation, and we never really felt the effects of racism and injustice. And now it seems some 50 years later from the time of the Civil Rights Movement and the Black Power Movement that racism is sticking its head up again. We live in a day where about a year from now that we'll be struggling as we're struggling now with what bathrooms our children can use.
Yes.
And it won't be long before I'm sure there'll be applications where you will be unable to say male or female. It'll just be whatever. That's the day we live in. Y'all help me say amen. I'm not going to be wrong. We live in a day where there is an actual chance that Donald Trump can become president. And that alone should frighten us. Said that to say that our country, as much as we have advanced in technology and as easy it is for us to touch each other, we are at an all-time high in terms of just immorality. That we live in a day where people do whatever they want, whenever, to whoever they want, however they feel like it. Not just in the world, not just in politics, but it's also in the body of Christ. I told some people a few years ago that we are not prepared for the civil war. We were prepared to fight the world, but we're not prepared to fight the different ideologies that raise up in the church.
Amen.
Y'all gonna help me today.
Amen.
And we need, especially my brothers, I'll talk to you all for a minute. We need men of God now more than ever. We need men that are going to stand, that are going to take their place. The church needs men. Look at somebody, tell them the church needs men. Church needs men that are going to stand, that are going to speak up, that are going to be there for their families, that are going to go and get our young men. We don't need you to talk to us with the church lingo. We don't need the church rhetoric. We need somebody that's going to talk and tell us the truth. And right now, we need the men who will be prophets of God that will stand up for the community, stand up for their family, stand up for their fellow brother and say, thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
Now understand, as we begin to move in our text, that's where we begin to find our text. And what's interesting is I would think that there would be a benefit plan for those of us who are called by God. I would think that because we are prophets of God, that we are men and women of God, that when we speak a thing, that we would be exempt from the same thing that we speak. But I've come to learn that just because you pray somebody through their cancer does not mean you're not, there's not a possibility that it can happen to you. What I'm trying to say is that all of us are subject to the very thing that we chase away. We are subject to a devil that we help somebody else get over. We are still subject to the same thing. But through that, God still expects us to maintain our posture. He expects us to still be who we are and to still do his will. Anybody know anything about dry places? Anybody know anything about famine when it hits your life? I'm talking about when you don't have enough, when you're struggling to make the basic ends meet, when you have more days than money. Anybody know what I'm talking about? When you gotta put the phone down because you don't recognize the number, and more than likely it's a bill collector and you just ain't got it. Tell somebody, I just ain't got it. I just ain't got it. And see, with that understanding and understanding that we have famine in our life, we would think that we should take a break from God because God understand I'm having a little struggle. But no. Just because we have famine in our life, we don't get the opportunity to take a break from our worship, take a break from our praise, because God is no less God because of a famine. We need to understand that God is still God in a famine. How do I know? Because I've had days when I didn't have enough, but it seems like there was always a way made. Anybody can testify that I ran out of money by the 5th, but I'm glad my light stayed on until the 31st. I wish I had a person in here that could testify that God kept me through a famine, that God kept me when I didn't have enough, where my church at, that God still provided for me every day. Can you just give God a praise right there? So we find in our text that we find this man named Elijah. At the height of Israel's apostasy, the Bible says in the 17th chapter, Elijah the Tishbite tells us no forewarning of who he is. It's no background of who he is. That at the end of the day, Israel was at a time of rebellion, and out of nowhere, this Elijah comes on the scene. The Bible doesn't tell us who his mama was, who his daddy was. Didn't tell us that his father was a bishop, his mama was a prophetess, that they came from such and such jurisdiction or such and such district. All it says is Elijah the Tishbite. And that's good news for some of us who think we've been overlooked, who think that ministry and life and things are passing us by, because God is getting ready to introduce you from out of nowhere. I don't have nobody up in here. Is there anybody that can testify and help me that says God is about to unveil me to the world? I know people are overlooking me. I know people don't see me coming. Shake a neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, they never saw me coming. And they were laughing when God was preparing me. They were saying I wouldn't be when God was shaping me. And out of nowhere, here I come. Look at somebody and say, watch out. Here I come. Here I come. Here, I'm moving quick. And not only that, his job, my brothers and my sisters, was to confront Ahab. And what challenges me today is that we live and we have a body of Christ that wants to comfort and not confront.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
We have men and women who want to make concessions and not create confrontations. You cannot stand for righteousness and not expect a confrontation somewhere down the line. I wish I had a church up in here. At some point, you've got to be willing to say enough is enough. It ain't right. On the word of God, I stand. My grandmama used to say it like this, it's holiness or hell. And I know that sounds corny to us today, but we need somebody that's going to stand and be willing to confront issues. Oh my God, what am I talking about? We can't just have prayer meeting. We got to get out in the street and tell the police, tell the gang members, tell white on black, black on black, red on black, that is wrong and we got to confront it. Somebody shout glory in here. My God, we need people who are courageous enough to confront the issues. People who are courageous enough to get on the corner and tell those young men, pull your pants up because it's not attractive and it's not cute. We need, oh, y'all ain't saying nothing to me. We need men and women of God who's willing to walk up in the house and tell their family everything up in here is coming under suggestion, under subjection. Do I have a witness in here? See, Elijah's role at this point was to shake some things up and to shut some things down. And what we need is we need people that are not afraid to shake some things up and to shut some things down. There have been some things going on in your life. You need to shut it down. And there's some things not moving. You need to shake it up. I ain't got a church up in here tonight. You need to get in front of your family and say, I'm shutting down the drama. I'm shutting down all of the issues. I'm shutting down all of the backbiting. I'm going to shut it down. And for those things that are not moving the way they should, you need to be able to shake it up. Do I have any shakers up in here that says, by the power of God, I'm shaking up everything? That, oh, y'all ain't with me. Oh, my God. You need to walk in the authority and in the power of God that says, because I'm here, I'm shutting it down. And because I'm here, I'm shaking it up. Somebody shout glory in here. Look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, shut it down and shake it up. That's Elijah. He's here to shut it down and to shake it up. And let me just add this real quick. Elijah, I was getting tired now. I'm starting to feel like I want to preach. Elijah, he calls this famine. And not only did he call the famine, what amazes me is that he said there would be a famine, there will be no rain. And God answered him just like that. And I want to be a man of God that when I speak, whatever I say, yes, God answers me. That if I say it's over, then it's over. If I say it's time, then it's time. If I say let the heavens open up, then anybody want that kind of power with God? That whatever I say, God is willing to. I wish I had somebody to look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, I want that kind of power. That if I touch my daughter and say, be saved in the name of Jesus, it's gonna happen. If I touch my sister and say, you are healed, it shall happen. Oh my God, let's just practice real quick. I dare you to just start commanding some stuff. Come on, open up your mouth and just say what you want God to do and believe that he's gonna answer you just like that. I want that kind of power.
Right now.
Oh my God. But understand that even with that, doesn't make you,
yes,
oh my God, doesn't make you exempt from the very same thing you confront. And I think what we're scared of now, we're scared to talk some things because we're going to have to live with the same thing we are confronting. I'm talking now and y'all ain't saying nothing. And we especially as brothers, my grandmama used to use this word, we can't be henpecked. We can't be scared to say what we feel. There's nothing like a double talking man. There's nothing like a man that talks out of both sides of his mouth. Mean what you say and say what you mean, whether they like it or not. Oh my God, that's what we need. We need kingdom men that's gonna say, this is what I said, this is what I believe. I don't care if you like it, I still love you, but I said it, and God's gonna honor what I said, even if I got to live with it. Somebody shout glory! Look at a man and say, man, say it, say it, say it, say it. time for us brothers to start talking. It's time for us brothers to start confronting some Ahabs. Oh my God, the devil's been trying to control us. And let me help you, whatever you don't control will control you. Whatever you don't drive will drive you. Whatever you don't lead will lead you. But is there anybody in here that can say, I'm tired of being pulled from side to side? I'm tired of going around in circles. Enough is enough. It's over. Shout over. We have to deal with a famine, and before we can shout, give me 10 more minutes, I'm going to be done. Before we can shout about the rain, we got to go through some transitions. Am I talking good yet? I know Jamal and Jerome is coming. Y'all don't leave me out there by myself. Before we get to the rain, we got to go through some transitions. Some of us want to dance on the rain, but we don't want to go through the process. And everything has a process. Tell your neighbor, everything has a process. I don't care, you can't manipulate it, you can't sidestep it, but it's good for us to have to go through process.
Yes, hallelujah, say that.
To go through three major transitions for us Bible scholars here tonight. Before he gets to the rain, the Bible says after he declares a famine, the Bible says that the Lord sends him to a place called Cherith. When you understand that word, and when you begin to study and to exegete it, it means a place of cutting. Help me. It's an isolated place. It's a place where you spend time by yourself. And I don't know who I'm talking to, but some of us, the best place we can be right now is by ourselves. Oh my God. And there is a value, my brothers and my sisters, in living a hidden life.
Amen.
When nobody can find you, because if they can't find you, they can't talk about you.
Amen.
God ain't saying nothing to me. There's a value with being quiet at some point in your life without all the noise. Look at somebody. This is what we used to say back in the street in the 90s. Look at somebody and say, kill the noise, kill the noise. And some of us, we can't get the authenticity of God because we got so much noise. We got Instagram. We got Facebook. We got Snapchat. We got everything flashing through our ear and our eye gates. And we wonder why our anointing is not authentic, because we got so many other things besides God influencing who we are. But look at somebody and say, it's time to cut it.
It's time to cut it. Cut.
You gotta cut it because God wants to get the real you. Is there anybody that's tired of copycats? Is there anybody that's tired of YouTube pastors and YouTube prophets and social media pastors? Is there anybody tired of listening to somebody preach and say, I heard Bishop Jake say that on his live stream? God is, oh my God. You mean to tell me I serve a God that got to use social media to speak to me? No, if you get in your closet, get by yourself. God will tell you what you need to hear, but it requires a quiet place.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Yay, hallelujah.
It requires a cutting place. There are some people you've got to cut off. Help me, Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
But I don't want to focus on the people, because I'm not a hater preacher. I'm not that a people preacher.
That's right.
I've learned this, that God, what you won't let go of, God will make it let go of you.
Amen.
Oh my God. I don't know if anybody in here been there before, but I didn't understand why they weren't texting me back.
Hallelujah.
I didn't understand why they weren't calling me back. I didn't understand why they wouldn't speak to me no more. But when I got the revelation that God will cut them off for me, or make them cut me off, I started wiping my tears and started praising God, because the disconnect is necessary.
Yes.
Look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, the disconnect is necessary, because you can't bring some people into your abundance. You can't bring some behavior into your abundance. You can't bring some place into your abundance. Look at somebody and say, it got to be cut. It got to be cut. And while you're there in isolation, the blessing is that God still provides. He says, go to Cherethah. I've got to hurry, and I'll send a raven. I want you to drink from a brook, and I'm going to send a raven to bless you. Now understand, there's a difference between general provision and divine providence, divine provision. What happens is the brook is general provision. Anybody could drink from this particular brook and be blessed or sustain life. But God said, I'm going to send a raven right to where you are. Is there anybody here that's ready for a divine blessing? I'm not talking about something that everybody else has access to. But see, the reason why we're missing is because we'll look for a church blessing. We'll expect it to come in a three-piece suit or with some gaiters on. But how many people understand that God is going to use a dirty bird in this season? God is going to use some dirty things or some unconventional ways or some unusual people to give me the blessing that I need. I wish I had somebody that would give God a praise. You looking for it one way, but God said, I'm going to bless you with things. Oh, my God. Oh, don't y'all give me that sanctimonious look, because the reason why I know that God can use a dirty bird to bless somebody, because I was that dirty bird.
Yes, amen.
Where's my church? I lost y'all. Anybody know that you wasn't always clean, but God used you at a point in your life? You wasn't always together, but God used you to bless somebody else. Open up your mouth and give them some praise.
Hallelujah.
First transition is that of Cherith. Then he says, the brook dried up. Look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, you got to know when things dry up. And when things dry up, it's time to move. Oh my God, I know some of us brothers, if y'all are like me, I'm a creature of habit. I like things the same way all the time. I like my remote control on the table. Don't nobody touch it. Don't nobody move it where I look for it. But sometimes or another, what you're looking for ain't always there. And you got to shift your thinking and be ready for something new. Part of our problem is we still trying to drink water in dry places. And the Bible, the God said, I've made that place dry up, and it's time for you to shift. Can you just lean on your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's time for you to shift. You've been in that transition long enough. You've been in that place long enough. God has dried everything up. But I dare you to lift your hand and say, I've got to move. I've got to move. I've got to move. And we've got to move to this next transition called Zarephath. And when you understand it, I've got to rush because I want to be done in the next 3 minutes. When you understand, we move from a place of cutting to this place called Zarephath, which means testing and refining. After God has cut some things from you, then he's got to refine you and reshape you and change you and make you better. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, the Lord is making me better. It's interesting that he moves from the place of Cherith to this place of Zarephath, and he meets a woman who has a need, but he challenges her to be a blessing. Oh my God, and not only that, but Elijah, he didn't have everything he needed, but he was still available to let God use him to work a miracle in somebody else's life. And you know you've grown up when you don't have enough, but you still say, yes, Lord, you can use me. Oh my God, I ain't got nobody up in here. I'm trying to close, y'all. Come on and help me. You know that you have grown up and matured when you are struggling, but you can still help somebody else. Oh my God, when God, see, that's the way God wants to see if will we give him everything, will we still be able to be used even when we need. Some of us want the abundance, but God said, I want to see if will you honor me right where you are. I know you only got $5, but are you willing to put it in the basket and trust me for the rest? Somebody shout glory up in here. As a matter of fact, let's do one more practice. Just get a neighbor by the hand. Get one neighbor by the hand, and I'm getting ready to close. And say, neighbor, I don't have everything I need, but shake that hand and say, in the name of Jesus, receive your miracle. Tell them, right now it's not about me. Right now it's not about my needs. But right now I bless you in the name of Jesus. I wish I had somebody that would give God praise, because it ain't about me, but it's about somebody else. And in this testing place, God wants to know, can you put yourself aside and help somebody else?
Yes, Lord.
Gotta move from that point. I don't have time, superintendent, to work it. I gotta move. I hope I'm doing all right. So he takes him from a place of cutting to a place of refining. And finally, he takes him to a place of at Carmel. And this Carmel represents a place of settling. Now understand that before he got to the abundance of rain, that Elijah had to settle some things. Talk up in here, Mac. I'm gonna do my best. That before he could get to his abundance, there were some doors that he had to close. The Bible says that after a long while, that the word of the Lord came to Elijah and said, go show yourself because I'm about to send rain. Oh my God, that's encouraging to me, my brothers and my sisters, because I would have thought that God would have forgotten about me between my place of cutting and my place of refining. But look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, even though you may have forgotten the promise, tell them the good news is that the promise hasn't forgotten you. I need somebody to help me up in here. Look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, I know you've been going through some tough things. I know you've been going through a famine, and it will make you think that God has forgotten about you. But look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm so glad that the promise did not forget my name. Is there anybody that can give God a praise up in here? I feel like preaching and y'all sitting on me. Just shake a neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, the promise has not forgotten my name. But before I get it, I've got to settle some things. Understand, my brothers and my sisters, that when we get to this point of the text, Elijah didn't wait for the enemy to show up. He decided, I was going to the enemy. And is there somebody in here that can say, I'm not going to wait another day for the fight to come to me? I'm bringing the fight to the death. Where's my church? Where's my church? Some of us, we're waiting for something to be fixed. And I come with a word to tell you that it won't be fixed until you get up and fix it yourself. Walk in the power and preach up in here. Walk up in the power that God has given you. And don't be afraid and say it is settled in the name of Jesus. Is there anybody here under the sound of my voice that got some issues you got to settle? You got some things you got to close. There's some doors you got to close. You're waiting for a new door, but God said, I'm not opening a door until you close the one you're in right now. Why don't you shake your neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, close the door. Close the door. Come on, tell them, close the door. Notice, my brothers and my sisters, as we look in our text, that it's at Carmel where Elijah settles things. It's at his place of worship where offerings are sacrificed to God that he settles things. Now understand this real quick, that while he's at Carmel, he is fighting two extremes. On one hand, there is God, and on the other hand, there is the prophet Baal. Oh my God, it sounds like some of us, that how do we wrestle with two extremes in the place of worship? On one end, we love God with all our heart, but on the other end, we're still struggling with the little things that's holding on to us. Preach up in here, Matt. On one end, we're ready to give God everything we have, but on the other end, there's still something that's antagonizing us. The Bible says something before I get to the rain, that after the prophets gave their worship, Elijah rebuilt the altar. And I came to tell everybody in here, before you get to your abundance, you better learn how to rebuild the altar. That's why the church is in some of the position that it's in, because we think that the Holy Ghost is in lights. We think that the Holy Ghost is in music. We think that the Holy Ghost is in a praise break and a drum machine. We think that the Holy Ghost is in whooping and hollering. But I don't know about y'all, but when I was messed up, didn't know where I was going, I found him at the altar. Is there anybody that knows what I'm talking about? And look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, you've got to rebuild your altar. And not only rebuild it, but if you read the text, you got to put your needs on the altar. You got to put the very thing that you don't want to give up on the altar. Elijah put water on the altar in the midst of a famine. But look at somebody and say, I need God so bad, I'm willing to put whatever I need on the
altar. Is there anybody here that knows what I'm talking about? I've been in a dry place so long. I've been dealing with this open-ended issue for so long that I'm ready to put it on the altar. Well, lean on your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm ready, chief. Tell them, put it on the altar. I don't know who I'm talking to. I feel an old school anointing real quick. I don't know who I'm talking to, but some of us, we've been dealing with the same thing over and over again. But I dare you to put it on the altar, because that at the altar will all of your issues be settled. And look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, I don't know about you, but I'm ready for the rain. But before I get to the rain, there are some things that I gotta settle. Anybody in here ready to settle some issues? Anybody in here ready to say enough is enough? I didn't understand why some things were cut. I didn't understand why my life was refined. And I didn't understand why I had to settle. But the Bible says that after he was done at Carmel, that the word of the Lord came to him and said, I hear the sound of the abundance of rain. That's why God did what he had to do, because he's ready to shower down some rain in your life. Is there anybody here that's ready for the rain? Can you high five your neighbor and say, neighbor? Y'all didn't say it. Say, neighbor. I didn't understand it, but tell them I understand now. I'm ready for the rain. I've had some dry things in my life. I had some dry people in my life. My job was dry. My marriage was dry. And God took me through the process just to get me ready for the rain. Can I get somebody in this place that'll give God praise and say the rain is coming?
The rain is coming.
The rain is coming.
The rain is coming.
The rain is coming. Come on. The rain is coming. I had to be cut. I had to be tested. I had to settle some things. But I'm so glad that I survived the transition, and I'm ready for the rain. Is there anybody under the sound of my voice that'll say I'm ready for the rain? Say
the Bible says that after he heard the rain, he told his servant, he said, go out there and tell me what you see. Oh my God. He said, he went out there and he said, I don't see anything. He said, go out there again. You good? Come on, I need you. He said, go out there again. He said, I need you to see what I hear. And I don't know who I'm talking to tonight, but what God gives you in your ear, you need somebody that'll see what you hear. In other words, if Apostle Jones gets up and say, I heard the Lord say, I see a brand new building, he needs somebody to say, I saw a building over there.
Yes! Hallelujah!
I just felt something. I'm gonna share.
Hallelujah.
Stand on your feet. Stand on your feet.
Hallelujah.
Stand on your feet. Stand on your feet.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Tells them.
Thank you, Lord.
Go look.
Yes, sir.
Tell me what you see.
Uh-huh.
He says, the final time, I don't see much. I see something the size of a man's hand. Look at a neighbor and say, neighbor, don't sleep on the small things. Y'all ain't excited enough for me. Tell somebody, I just need to see a glimpse. I don't need to see the whole picture.
I don't need to see everything. I just need to see a glimpse. As a matter of fact, look at somebody and say, neighbor, I see just enough to get ready for the rain. I see just enough to get ready for the outpour. Is there anybody here that can say, I don't see the whole thing, but I see just enough. So get ready for the rain. High five your neighbor and say, neighbor, get ready, the rain is coming, and when it comes, it's gonna fall all over me. I'ma be dancing in the rain, I'ma be shouting in the rain, I'm gonna be running in the rain. Say somebody say, neighbor, I can see clearly now. I can see clearly now. God had to cut some things. God had to fix some things. God had to settle some things. But tell him I can see clearly. Ask your neighbor, what do you see? Tell him I don't see a whole lot. I see just enough to get me started. I see just enough to move forward. I see just enough to get ready. Lean on your neighbor and say, neighbor, get ready. Y'all didn't say it to say it until you feel it. Say, get ready. Get ready. I see a crown. Get ready. I see my healing. Get ready. I see deliverance. Get ready. I'm ready. say neighbor. We're moving from famine to more than enough. Everything connected to me, everything that's got my name on it is blessed. Everything I touch is blessed. Touch somebody and say you're blessed. You're blessed. You're blessed. You're blessed. You're blessed. I'm in my anointing. I'm in my flow. The rain is coming to my life. And I'm ready to dance in it. I'm ready to shout in it. I'm ready to scream in it. I'm ready. Let it rain on me. Even Leon, let some drops fall on me. Say can I get somebody to go to dancing, go to shouting, go to looping, give God praise, cause the rain